Continue. Let's again have a word of prayer. Thank you, Father, again for bringing us together here to continue the study. We know that you are the teacher, and you sent us the Holy Ghost to reveal to us things ahead of us, so that we may be prepared to meet you as we appear in the clouds of heaven. I beg you again to take me over. Use my vessel, the vessel which is yours, and give me the tongue of the wise, which is able to use the knowledge aright. You've given us enough knowledge, but we want to use it aright in our lives. May you please visit us and visit your saints who are before you and before you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Psalms 89, verse 19. That's where we were. Where God, speaks about Jesus Christ. Then you spoke in vision to your Holy One and said, I have laid help upon one that is mighty. I have exalted one chosen out of the people. This scripture tells that Jesus is mighty, is strong, and is the only one mighty in the whole world among the people. Jesus is being here prophesied that he is going to come, mighty power above Satan's power. And of this one again, John in the Revelation chapter 5, verse 5, one of the elders says unto me, do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals. Jesus is here being foretold as the Lion of the tribe, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, who is able to open the book. You see this word prevailed. We saw this word in the name Israel. In the name Israel, a prevailer is mentioned, and that is only Jesus Christ being spoken about. So Jesus, anybody who substitutes man, anybody who is going to die in the place of man, or anybody who is going to rule this world, must be a prevailer. Must have the ability to conquer the power of Satan. Must have the ability to conquer every force of evil which Satan may use in this world. I remember Isaiah 8, verse 12. Let's go there. Isaiah 8, verse 12. The confederacy of evil, there are so many organizations in this world. There are so many forces that Satan has put up in this world in order to fight the battle with Jesus Christ. But there's a promise in Isaiah 8 verse 9 which says, associate yourselves. I mean, bring yourselves together. But even though you bring yourselves together, your power shall be broken. Because there's one mightier than you who is going to break you down. Give ear, O ye of far countries. Gather up yourselves and stand up. But your standing shall be broken in pieces. You can make economism the stand. You can bring yourself together in ecumenism. You can bring together all the forces of evil together. You take counsel together, the stand. But it shall come to naught. It will not reach its objectives. God is with us. So in this man, Jesus, God is with us. His name is Emmanuel. He might be stronger than the strong one. There is the one who was strong, and he brought sin into this world. He brought downfall to Adam, which means he was stronger than Adam. But then there comes somebody who is stronger than him. Jesus talked about it in Luke chapter 11, 22, 23, 21, 22. By the time when he said, when a strong man armed keeps his palace, his goods are in peace. But when a stronger than him shall come upon him and overcome him, he takes from him all his armor wherein he trusted and devises spoil. Jesus was speaking here about himself, that he's stronger than the one who calls himself strong, Satan. He will invade all the compounds of Satan. He will break down all the forces of Satan which has put in this world. He will conquer. If I take him, he will conquer for me. There's no force of evil which can prevail against Jesus. In the Zeal of Ages, somewhere in the chapter about the true sign, there is a statement which says, like seeks like. In other words, when a forces of evil looks for another forces of evil to unite themselves against the good, the forces of evil, if the spirit of Satan is in you and it's in me, we will come together. We join our forces in order to fight against the good which is in Christ Jesus. But even those unions which are being formed around us, these are forces of evil coming together. Here we are promised that they will not prevail. Jesus is stronger than them. You remember that story about Elisha with his servant? When the soldiers came to attack Elisha, his servant couldn't see them. But he saw only the forces of which were surrounding him, which had besieged the city where Elisha was. And Elisha comforted him and said, "Don't worry. Be not fearful. Those who are with us are stronger than they." And then he prayed, "God, open his heart. Open his eyes." And when he opened his eyes, he saw a mountain of soldiers. I had a dream one time when I was a young man. I was in high school. And I had this dream, strange one. The forces of evil were fighting in my heart. Then this dream was about hunters. They were clothed in black clothes. The dogs, which were also used to hunt, they were in dark, they were in black color. And they were hunting me. They were running after me. Then I ran with my force. I ran with my force. But I was not faster than the dogs. When they were about to catch me and bite me, I saw somebody before standing for me, a soldier, a tall soldier. And then he said, "Come to me." I went to him and I embraced him. And he says, "Fear not. Look behind me." And when I looked behind on his shoulder, I saw a mountain of soldiers who were clothed, in the same vapors, in the same weapons, the clothing of the soldiers. It was a mountain. So he said, "Don't fear, because those who are running after you, they're just few. If you continue to to abide with me and serve me, they will not eat you. Those dogs will not eat you.
Amen.
But if you let me go, I will let you be eaten by those dogs. I was a young man, facing my problem, but this is a dream from God to let me know, to let me, young man, don't fear, I'm with you.
Amen.
And since that, God has been with me up to now. Man's substitute must be prevailer. He must have the ability to prevail. This one I've read it, right? This one who could accomplish man's recovery and who became man's substitute is none other, is Christ the Messiah, the sent of God. Many, 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 many prophecies are pointing to him as the man's substitute. He will be our king in the new heaven, in the new earth. He will be our king. He is our king. He's the one who is going to replace Adam. We are his subjects. We are his subjects. When he came for the first time, he established the kingdom of grace. But when he comes for the second time, he will establish the kingdom of glory, which will be for eternity. And he's looking for his subject, with whom he will inherit the new earth, which is made new. This is a quotation from the Spirit of Prophecy. The Son of God, heaven's glorious commander, was touched with pity for the fallen race. His heart was moved with infinite compassion as the walls of the lost world rose up before him. But divine love had conceived a plan whereby man might be redeemed. The broken law of God demanded life from the sinner. In all the universe, there was but one who could, in behalf of man, satisfy its claims. Since the divine law is as sacred as God himself, only one equal with God could make atonement for its transgression. None but Christ could redeem a fallen man from the curse of the law and bring him again into harmony with heaven. Christ will take upon himself the guilt. As I said earlier, God took the guilt upon himself and shame of sin, which is so offensive to a holy God that it must be separated from the Father and Son. Christ will be reached to the depths of misery to rescue the ruined race. Before the Father, he pleaded in the sinner's behalf. While the host of heaven awaited the result, with an intensity of interest that words cannot express, long continued towards that mysterious communion, the Council of Peace. We read that in Zechariah 6:13. For the fallen sons of man, the plan of salvation had been laid before the creation of the earth. For Christ is the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. Revelation chapter 13, verse 8. Yet it was a struggle, even with the King of the universe, to yield up his son to die for the guilty race. But God so loved the world that he gave his own begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. This statement directs me to Genesis chapter 22, when Abraham was being told to go and sacrifice Isaac. Because that story is a very good illustration of the atonement. The story of Abraham and his son is a very good illustration of the atonement. And chapter 22 of Genesis, God tells Abraham, and it came to pass after this thing that God tempted Abraham. And he said unto him, Abraham, he said, behold, I'm here. And he said unto him, take now thy son. Now, mark these words. Take now thy son. And then mark the following word. Thy only son, Isaac. Was he the only one?
No.
He was not the only one, but in a special relationship, he was the son of promise. That's why Isaac carries the attributes of, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. To Abraham, Isaac was the only begotten son, whom he loved so much, the Bible says, whom you love so much. You know, God used the words, exactly wording, which was in his heart toward Jesus Christ. Whom you love, your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love. Jesus is a beloved son of the universe, of God. We were given a special gift in Jesus. Man had no part in the plan of salvation. Only God could devise a way whereby man might again be restored to the Father of heaven. This purpose of God to recover man is forcibly suggested in the following statement. I like this verse. When you go to my email, or if I sent you an email, my handwriting in my email has got this verse. It has got this verse. It says, for we must needs die. When I first met this world, I really saw how useless we are. I really saw how we cannot save ourselves. It is impossible. We cannot save ourselves. There's nothing that we can do to take ourselves from down there where we fell, from where we fell. We can't. We have drowned into the sea. Somebody has to plunge into the sea in order to come and lift us up from the ocean. Look at this world. Where am I? Yeah, here. For we must needs die. And we are as water spilt on the ground, which cannot be gathered up again. We are as water spilt on the ground, which cannot be gathered up again. Question comes, who can gather up water which you have just put on the ground? Can you? And there's only one who can, and that's God. Trying to save yourself is kicking against the pricks. Whatever you're doing, trying to save yourself, is filthy ruggedness. We cannot do nothing. We can do in order to save ourselves. We need somebody to pick us up, and that somebody mustn't be able to do that. And there's only one who can do that. It's God Himself in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
This God of ours, who loves us, who has no respect of persons, is the one who devised the means to save us. Long before we even existed. Me, I was born in 57. Just yesterday, this plan was there. When I came up as a baby into this world, this plan was there. I just need to accept it or reject it. And this banished be not expected from him. Who spoke these words, if I may ask? Who spoke these words? And to whom was he speaking? If you remember the story very well, Joel was talking to David. He was talking to David. Because, was it Absalom who was hunting his father to kill him. He wanted to replace his father to the throne. And he flee the palace, never to come back before the king. He stayed 3 years long without coming back into the home. And Joab, through the Holy Spirit, he puts the words in the mouth of Joab in order to convince David to let his son come back home. Then he convinced David that we are all as water, which cannot be gathered up again. We all need to be forgiven. Remember the sin you've committed. Even if you're a king, you're not innocent. God came down where we were, in the ocean, in order to be able to pick us up. He has to become like we are. He became man. He had immortality. And God gave, how can I say it? In English, in Dutch language, we say opdracht. Opdracht. In English, we say assignment. The Father gave the assignment to Jesus to go and give his life so that he can take it up again. Jesus had an updraft from the Father. He had an assignment from the Father to give his life, and he was given the capacity, because he had the capacity, and he was given the capacity to take it up again. When did they get this word? It's Jesus himself who spoke it to the disciples. My Father gave me, he told me, give his life and then take it up again. So he became man in order to raise man from the depths where he was. No angel could do that. Because angels are different orders of creation. So man substitute can be only somebody who can pick us, who can gather the water which is powered down. And that is only God who can do that. But the characteristic of being God must be forfeited and he become man. Because man, God is not, he's not what? He cannot die. Yeah? God cannot die. So, before he has the qualities of death, he has to become man like a man. And that's why the Bible says Jesus accepted to put on himself our nature. Sinful nature. Sin. In order to save us. Death. In order to save us. He exchanged his life with our death. We gave him our death. He gave us his life. This joint combination is illustrated by the dream Jacob had on his way from running away from Esau. And this is what is needed in order for us to be princes, prevailers, conquerors, fighters of good faith. This is what we need. We need a combination in our nature. We don't only need one human nature. We only need the nature which Jesus Christ had, divine combined with man's nature. This joint combination of God and man is beautifully taught by the dream which God gave to the patriarch Jacob at the time he fled from his brother Esau to journey to his uncle Laban. In his dream, Jacob saw a ladder extending from earth to heaven. One end of the ladder was in heaven, and the other end was fixed upon the earth. You can read this story in Genesis 28. So Jesus had two natures, divine and human. And for us to win the war, We have to have these two natures in us. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4 says, 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4 says, we have exceedingly great promises in this word of God. Through these exceedingly great promises, we partake of the divine nature freely. We partake of the divine nature through these promises. And through this combination, we become conquerors. We escape the corruption that is in this world. These are our ages, page 286. Christ took upon himself humanity, that he might reach humanity. Divinity needed humanity, for it required both the divine and human nature to bring salvation to the world. It requires a combination of divine and human nature to be a conqueror. Without these two, there's no conquering, there's no winning the war. We have already human nature, and Jesus is offering freely divine nature. 1 Corinthians 15, 45 to 47, I talked about it a little bit, and so it is written, the first Adam was made a living soul, and the last Adam was made a quickening spirit. The first man is of the earth, earthy, and the second man is of the Lord from heaven. The Son of God would become man, and God accepted the substitute. And the first part of the atonement was effected. The first part of the atonement was effected when God accepted the offer, the sacrifice of his Son. Okay, I accept. You go to die for man. You go to die instead of Adam. You go to die instead of humanism. You go to die instead of whosoever is going to believe in your name. The Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Jews came to Jesus and asked him, what should we do in order to enter into an eternal life? What are the works that we could do? You know, they had done so many forms and ceremonies and whatever, but still they felt emptiness in themselves, and they came to Jesus. What can we do in order to earn eternal life? What works can we do? There's no other work that you can do to earn eternal life, Jesus says, except to believe in whom God has sent. If you believe in whom God has sent into this world to be your substitute, so you don't need to die, you will have eternal life. Finished. With this, we finish the first part of atonement, Bible study. If time allows, I will know on Monday. I will communicate my sister when I'll be able to come, and we will continue part 2, which is already prepared. Part 3 and 4 will come later, maybe next year, I don't know. I thank you for your giving me your attention. I thank sister for inviting me. I'm burning with this message of atonement, because when you told me that I would come, God directed me to FCG God, and he directed me to the 4 sections of the atonement. We need to understand our relationship with Jesus Christ. We need to understand our relationship with God. We need to understand the plan of salvation in what it means for Jesus to go on the cross of Calvary for us instead of we ourselves. Let us pray.
Christus is volledig God, 100% God. Maar hij heeft ook heeft de goddelijke natuur en ook de menselijke natuur aangenomen. Ja? Is dat zo? Want wat is de menselijke natuur dan? Want als hij de menselijke natuur heeft aangenomen, dan kan hij toch niet voor mij aan het kruis sterven, of wel?
Wat kan alles?
Dan heeft hij zelf een verlossing nodig. Daar gaat het bij mij om.
God kan alles.
Daar gaat het bij mij om. Als hij gezondigd heeft, dan heeft hij ook een verlossing nodig. En hij heeft niet gezondigd.
Nee, hij heeft niet gezondigd. Nee.
Bomba zei daarachter. Ben jij?
Ja.
Bomba. Bomba.
Hij heeft niet gezondigd.
Nee.
Bomba.
Jezus heeft volledig eigenlijk, hij was totaal mens en totaal God. Hij mocht nooit niet gebruik maken van zijn Godheid om als mens ons voorbeeld te zijn. Hij moest in alles verzocht worden zoals wij. Maar hij was totale mens in zijn geweest en is en totaal God. Anders kost hij onze verlossenis zijn. De Heilige Geest. Jezus is niet met de erfzonde geboren. Dat is een groot verschil. Jezus is geboren door de Heilige Geest. Hij kon wel zondigen, anders was het een kleurspel. Hij kon gemakkelijk zondigen, maar Satan heeft al het mogelijke gedaan omdat hij zou van zijn Godheid gebruik maken. En dat mocht hij niet, want hij moest mens blijven, hij moest klein blijven, zoals wij. En dat is zo belangrijk voor ons, dat hij overwonnen heeft.
Ja? Broeder had ons daarachter uitgelegd. Jezus kon volledig mens zijn en zijn Godheid behouden, omdat hij Jezus door de Heilige Geest is gewekt bij mijn moeder. Daarom kon hij 100% mens zijn en 100% zijn goddelijkheid bewaren. Dat was gewoon pas een
moment. Nee, I think you can answer that question. Because she's wondering if Jesus took upon himself our sinful nature, he's also in need of a savior. Is that what you mean?
No,
Als hij onze zonde heeft aangenomen, dan kan hij dus ook in het zonde vervallen. Hij is niet ervoor gekozen. Hij is verleid, maar hij heeft niet aan zonde toegegeven. Maar hier gaat het om als hij volledig
God is. Hè? De goddelijke natuur heeft, maar ook de menselijke natuur. En doordat hij de menselijke natuur heeft, volledig mens is geworden.
Ja.
Hoe kan hij dan? Dan zou hij toch zelf. Want ik ben in de war met vorige week.
Ja. Je zei dan zou hij ook zondaar zijn. Dus toen had hij ook zelf redder. Dat legde je me net uit.
Als hij ons menselijke natuur had aangenomen. Want wat is dat? Dan wil ik weten wat de definitie is van menselijke natuur.
Ja, ik wou even met u 2 Korinthe 5 lezen. 2 Korinthe 5, 18 en 19. Laten we 2 Korinthe 5. 18-19 gaan lezen. De Bijbel zegt. Tweede Korintje 5, vers 18-19. We mogen ook 21 lezen straks. And all things are from God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Verse 19. To wit that God was in Christ. God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses upon them, but has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Verse 21. For he has made him. God has made him. Ikerahab. God has made him. What has God made Jesus? What has God made Jesus? What has God made Jesus?
To be sin.
To be sin. God has made Jesus to be sin for us. Okay? The fourth and the verse. Who knew no sin? He was made zonde. Wie diegene die de zonde niet wist, werd gemaakt een zonde te zijn. That he might be made the righteousness of God in us, in him. Nou, wat is volledige menselijke natuur? Is sinful nature. Menselijke natuur is sinful.
Wat bedoel ik? Als Christus, een menselijke natuur, zondige menselijke natuur.
Ja, die heeft Jezus Christus zich aangenomen.
Juist. Ja,
maar hij had ook divine nature.
Klopt.
En mensen van beide, a combination of the two natures, gave him conquer. He was always dependent upon his father as a man. And he came to teach us to be also dependent upon him if you want to win. But Satan came with another doctrine. People don't want to believe that Jesus had a sinful nature. They simply don't want to believe that. That's why they even exalted Mary, his mother, to the level of divine. And they say Mary didn't have this nature. Because if he had this nature, he wouldn't have produced a son of God. That's why they worship him. He was put to the level of the divine, of the Godhead, I could say. Mary was put to the level of Godhead.
Yeah.
Because they believe that God can only listen when they talk to Mary. But the moment we be driven into that belief, then you have to be very careful. 1 John chapter 2:22. 1 John chapter 2:22. 1 John chapter 2:22. Wait a minute. Yeah, no. 1 John chapter 4. I'm sorry. Yeah, chapter 4. In Johannes 4. And I'm reading verse 1 to 2, 3. Beloved, don't believe every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are from God. Because many false prophets have gone out into the world. Hereby shall we know the spirit which comes from God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that confesses, does not confess that Jesus Christ is come with the flesh, is not coming from God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, which you have heard that should come into the world. And even now it is already in the world. So the teaching which do not believe that Jesus Christ came for later as a man, is Antichrist. It does not come from God. Otherwise, no, Jesus, you say Jesus needed a savior. Of course, the spirit of him, the spirit of God, raised him from the dead. The spirit of God was with him wherever he went. He was dependent upon his father. Just the same way we are dependent upon our father. He was teaching us not to yield to temptation.
There
is a difference between
being a sinner and taking upon
one's yes,
sinner.
Yes, my sister.
Brother, Pedro is saying, look at John, John 10, chapter 10. 17 and 18.
17, 18. John, let's go to 17, 18. John 17, 18. John 10, 17. Okay. John 10, 17, 18. John 10, 18 says. John 10.
17.
Okay. 17. The prayer of Jesus. John 17, verse?
17.
17.
17 and 18.
Okay. Sanctify them through thy truth.
Therefore doth my Father love me, because I laid down my life, that I might take it again.
That's right.
No man take it from me, but I lay it down myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received from my Father.
Ik heb het erover gezegd. Hij zei, de vader gaf hem een opdracht zijn leven af te geven en op te nemen nog een keer. Question? My sister, you had a question? Or a comment? An observation?
A comment.
Yeah.
Because the Bible says that Jesus took our sins upon himself.
Yeah.
And that is a different than being a sinner.
Yeah.
Yes.
And this is maybe words that we also need to be careful.
Yes.
Jesus took upon himself the sin of the world, but he was not a sinner. And to me, when we go back to Genesis and we see that God made man, he made man without sin. And it was his choice, to fall into sin, as we have today also the choice either to sin or to abide in Christ.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
What was the grote verzoeking voor Jezus?
Yeah. What was the greatest temptation of Jesus?
Hij moest nooit gebruik maken van zijn godheid.
Ja.
En hij moest klein blijven zoals wij.
Ja.
En dat was een grote beproeving. Satan heeft al het mogelijke gedaan omdat Jezus van zijn godheid zou gebruik maken.
Ja.
Maar hij mocht niet. Hij was mens, moest hij blijven.
Exactly. He denied himself. He denied himself. Jesus denied himself. He was godlike. He was godlike. He was divine. But he denied himself. He left it af en werd mens volledig en nooit heeft die goddelijke natuur gebruikt.
Juist, hij mocht dat niet eens gebruiken.
Nee.
Ja. Ik heb nog één vraag. U heeft gezegd dat, hoe zei het ook weer, dat op het moment dat wij de verleidingen op ons pad krijgen, zijn ze al afgewogen. Zijn ze bekeken en ze, Beverly kan dat aan, no worry. Dus ik hoef eigenlijk, houd het in, dat dat ik ongeacht wat door die verleiding heen kom, want Christus heeft dat al overzien, afgewogen en gezegd van nee, het gaat goed. Dus ik hoef eigenlijk niet meer te bidden. Dan hoef ik niet meer te vragen, leid mij niet in verzoeking.
Dus dat is... There's a statement of Ellen G. White. There's a statement of Ellen G. White which says, we should not parley with temptations. Parley with temptation is to make a conversation with Satan. Just the way Adam and Eve made a conversation with a snake. Eve was not supposed to talk with a snake. No. He was supposed to trust what God said, without even talking about what the new ideas which the snake is bringing.
Wat wil zeggen, hij werd tot zonde gemaakt voor ons.
Jezus Christus, ja.
Waarom werd hij tot zonde, wat had hij gedaan? Hij nam de zonde van de mensen op zich.
Op zich, ja.
En daarom werd hij gerekend tot de zondaar.
Ja, maar nu gaat het hier om. Dus
hij werd tot zonde gemaakt, maar hij was niet zonde. Nee. Hij was niet zondig, maar hij werd op zonde gemaakt omdat hij de zondige dingen opnam van de mensen.
Zuster, dat wil me helpen. Heeft u dat ook gehoord wat er gezegd is vandaag? Christus heeft alles al afgewogen en heeft gezegd, go, ze komt er doorheen. Ja, zoals Jezus. Ja, toch?
Ik weet wat je bedoelt. Okay, ja.
Dat heb ik goed begrepen. En dat heeft hij net gezegd.
Dat was de deel waar hij vertelde dat God daar de uitleg gaf van Job. Dus God had gezien van, je kan mijn dienaar Job...
Heb je mijn dienaar Job gezien?
Ja.
Dat hij al wist dat Job dat kon doorstaan. Hij kon het handelen.
Ja.
Ja? Is dat dan ook bij mij het geval? Dat vind ik ook zo dat ik dat begrijp en denk van, als er verleidingen komen op mijn weg, dat ga ik eventjes aan, dat ga ik opknappen. Dat kan wel, want Christus heeft het al afgewogen, ik kom maar doorheen.
Ja, precies. Dat is.
Soms kan ik niet op mijn trap trappen denken van, ik ga dat overwinnen, terwijl ik daar helemaal niet moest zijn.
We always overcome trials and temptations so long as we connect ourselves to the source of power. Together with Jesus Christ, together with Him, that whatever temptations can come, He will conquer for us. He will win for us. He wants only us to connect ourselves to Him, rely on Him, and not start thinking, okay, I'm going to do it myself. Because the same way Jesus was not tempted to use his divine nature, Satan wants to tempt us to use our sinful nature alone. When we start using our nature alone, without the divine nature of Jesus Christ, then we fail. We fail. Just the same way Jesus, if he had used the divine nature, no soldiers could have touched him. If he had used his divine nature, he wouldn't have needed to be hungry in the desert. If he had used his divine nature, he wouldn't have needed to say, Father, let your will be done, not my will. His will was divine, but he never used it. He gave it up for us. And he became man who was dependent upon his Father. And we are supposed also to unite ourselves with the source of power. Together, whatever temptation comes, he is going to kick it off on our behalf.
And I think this is what God has foresaw. He foresaw that, and this is what God has foresaw in God and Job's life. He foresaw that whatever happened, Job would be with him and not rely upon his own strength.
He even told his wife.
Yeah.
You know what he told his wife? I think you have to pray and come to an end.
Yeah. Toen de mens gezondigd had, ging het verlossingsplan in gang gewoon.
Ja.
En Jezus is tot 3 maal toe in de Vader ingegaan, staat in de eerste geschriften.
Ja.
En het heeft voor God moeite gekost om zijn zoon zo te laten vernederen tot de dood des kruises.
Ja.
En de derde maal kwam er hij met vrede eruit dat zijn vader het offer aanvaard had. Vergeet niet, Satan heeft al het mogelijke gedaan om Jezus zo te vernederen dat hij het zou opgeven. Dat het genoeg was.
Ja.
Tot de dood des kruises werd hij vernederd. En daardoor wordt hij dan ook gelauwerd door God. Ja. En is hij onze vrijspraak. Maar eigenlijk heeft God moeite gekost om zo zijn zoon te laten vernederen voor de ogen van mensen.
Ja.
En van de ganse telal zelf.
Maar wat is de reden dat Satan hem zo ver probeerde te krijgen dat hij op zijn verzoekingen zou ingaan? Waarom deed Satan dat? Want hij probeerde op allerlei manieren om de macht te krijgen.
Om zijn verlossing, want hij was de hij had zich aangemeld als de prins van deze wereld.
Satan had already usurped the power from Adam. He had his power, which had created from Adam. And when Jesus came, he wanted to kill Jesus when he was a baby.
Yeah.
It was not possible. He followed him wherever he was going. The Holy Spirit, the Bible says, took Jesus in the wilderness to be tempted. The Holy Spirit took Jesus in the wilderness to be tempted. Now, Satan knew that Jesus was in the desert. And he says, I cannot send my angels. I have to go myself. This time, if I don't win this war, I will lose the power of this world. Then Satan did whatever he could in order to win Jesus Christ, because he knew Jesus came to take the power from him. It is that in the Bible that he came to destroy all the works of the devil. He came to destroy the kingdom of Satan in my heart, in our lives, in this world.
Waarom zou Johannes gezegd hebben, zie het lam Gods? Heb je schapen onderzocht wat de schaap doet? Ik heb schapenboer geweest. En een schaap heeft de eigenschap, als het genomen wordt, gebonden wordt, dan geeft het zich. Het geeft zich totaal. Jezus heeft niks tegen weerwerk geboren.
Ja.
Hij heeft volledig aanvaard die vernedering.
We are going to pray, brother. Let's pray together before you go. I think let's pray to come to an end to study. Thank you, Father, for your love that you have revealed in Jesus Christ. Thank you for the plan of salvation that shows us that you want to live with us eternally. Thank you for this study you've given us this afternoon. May you give each one of us the light that we need to have in order to be able to be lights among darkness in this world. Give us, Father, this divine nature which we need, that Jesus Christ has brought in his dwelling with us through the Holy Ghost. Before we separate, may you grant us your traveling mercies until we meet again. In the name of Jesus I pray. Amen.
Amen.